The following program is classified G. It's suitable for all ages. We would like to remind our viewers that the views expressed in this program by our participating guests are solely viewpoints of them who take part and does not reflect the views and beliefs of the Verana Media Network. This is an opinion-based program.
On a special presentation of Get Real, Happy New Year, it's 2022. Sri Lanka rang in the new year with lots of hope for better days ahead. With the country's ailing economy, deteriorating political system, and more importantly, the negative mindsets carried forward from the year that passed, we have to ask ourselves, what can we do differently for a course correction? Liberal economists, pundits, and doomsdaysayers have done their part in predicting the worst for Sri Lanka in 2022. However, the government is optimistic in the new year, hoping that their stringent measures taken in the past few months would bear the results they hope. Despite the upbeat, the reality is that Sri Lanka will face the music before the standing ovation. So can the people of this country weather the music, or will we look for shortcuts that would eventually be a downfall in the long run? Economic growth, new foreign investments, re-establishing the tourism sector, and increase in the country's foreign reserves are some of the challenges in 2022 for the current administration, while the opposition and the naysayers will do their level best to disrupt, discord, and destroy in the new year as well. The toxicity of politics continues to rise. Sri Lankans too have a daunting challenge to be part of the revival of this nation instead of being footballs to political parties who use everything and everyone for their benefit. Where will Sri Lanka be heading in 2022 politically and economically? Will the worst get even worse? Or will we see a silver lining in this dark cloud? For insights and analysis, tonight on this New Year's Day, I am joined by the Director General of the Government Information Department, veteran journalist Mohan Samaranaike, and renowned economist Dr. Kenneth DeSilva.
Real views, real opinions, and for an honest conversation, this is Get Real, and it all starts right now.
Is a special presentation of Get Real. Flash forward 2022. The challenges ahead, the opportunities at hand, and what will define the year ahead. Now, reporting from Studio 24, here's Mahesh Jani.
Good evening. This is a special presentation of Get Real Flash Forward 2022. First and foremost, let me take this moment to wish you all a happy and prosperous 2022. We have gone through many things together. Despite our differences, we've experienced a conflict of over 25 years. We've seen the tsunami and, most importantly, recovered from it. Countless economic challenges, political upheaval, end of a war, many victories as a nation, and this time around, a pandemic. Yet, in all these instances, we have persevered. Sri Lankans are survivors and strong ones at that. Our resilience has always been our strength as a nation, and I wish nothing but the best for every Sri Lankan in 2022. Well, in my opening statement, pulling together. Now, in the past year, COVID defined every one of our lives. It forced us to live in a way we never wanted to live. With so much development and progress made in the world, we were surprised that such an event like COVID-19 could occur, because we always thought that the progress we made thus far would have been far superior to any threat we would have to experience. But we were wrong. So here we are, more than 100 years after the last global pandemic, facing another one. I recently saw in a magazine a cartoon of a man struggling to carry a record player, a fax machine, and a computer and a phone. The following caption showed the same guy with a tiny smartphone. The previous chaos was replaced with calm and efficiency. Now, we live in a world where that quiet evolution has always been a priority. So although nobody likes change, and the last 2 years have seen a lot of it, all the changes, past and present, are intended to support that same positive evolution. Our children and their children will inherit a better world, a better environment, and a better standard of living. Responding to COVID-19 has not been perfect. However, boy, we really need to pay our respects to our health workers, our frontline staff, the military, and even the government for the amount of hard work they've done to keep each of us safe. We will put this pandemic behind us, just like other big hills we have climbed as a nation. However, the post-COVID world will look different due to lessons we have learned thus far. And despite all your political differences, this government has done its very best to minimize the impact around the country from this pandemic. We should take this opportunity to recognize that effort, because without it, life today would be very different and history would judge us harshly. So as we go on with our lives, we are very easily distracted by the shiny stuff, the razzle, the dazzle that comes from time to time. And when it arrives, we very idiotically forget the things that have been by our side for quite some time. In fact, throughout our lives, we go chasing the temporary pleasures in life and forget those who have always been there with us. We fail to understand the subtlety in life and ignore them and lose everything. Our inability to understand and foresee has always been detrimental to our nation's growth. If you look at our growth since independence, we always blame, saying as a nation, we haven't grown, we haven't done this, we haven't done that, and always, always swift to blame the leaders of this country, not comprehending that it was us in the first place who elected and selected those very leaders that we scream at. In this new year, let's learn to understand the subtle blessings we've been given as a nation and not chase after the very short, very immediate pleasures in life and then lament about losing a better future for all of us. I always tell a friend of mine every day, you got to learn to read the room. Right now, there's a lot of urgency and noise asking our leaders to run to the IMF to get a loan so our immediate economic issues are sorted. But we need to understand the very reason we are, as a beggar state, is these loans we've been taking instead of finding a real solution to get out of the debt. Remember how much noise the liberal jokers were making during the election, saying this debt, that debt, this country is a debt country, all that nonsense. When someone steps in to solve that problem and persevere, hoping to find a new way to get away from our problems, those jokers are again calling us to run to the IMF to get another loan. It's the same thing with the organic fertilizer matter. During the election, those very jokers were screaming, saying, our healthcare is this, people's lives are at risk, and when a leader takes a tangible step to solve that problem, we do everything to make him look like a joke. Well, in this new year, let's not forget the people who are doing their very best to make us shine, support us, make our lives better, and then forget them and run towards a temporary thing that lasts for a few moments. Because when you do that, you only hurt the ones who have been there for you in thick and thin. Once you return after your temporary excursions, they will not be there for you anymore. And in the end, it's you who lose. In 2022, we will definitely face hardships, economically, politically, and for most of you personally as well. But just like that, we too will face victories as well. We should understand that for us as Sri Lankans, it's only us that's there, and that we got to do our part to be victorious as a nation and learn to pull together rather than pull apart. All right, my guest tonight, the Director General of the Government Information Department, veteran journalist Mohan Samaraika, and renowned economist Dr. Kenneth Silva, will join me shortly. But before that, Dhanadu Vithanavasam joins me right here in the studio to take a look at the New Year's version of the real story. Happy New Year to you, Dhanadu. Good to see you. Here we are in 2022. obviously we need to accept the fact that there's going to be a lot of challenges we got to face. But the silver line here is that we can face it as a united nation. What exactly are you focusing on the real story?
Well, Happy New Year to you too as well, Mahesh. I think you hit the nail on the head when you mentioned that it is our united response that will be the decisive factor when it comes to how we proceed to 2022. And that is literally where we are going to focus and to look at the prospectus, to look at the outlook of what 2022 would look like. Now, as crucial as 2021 has been, the year 2022 will also be decisive in the developmental outlook of Sri Lanka. Critical regions of concern have been led by the economy and the general future of the country. Therefore, it is essential to have a breakdown of what to expect regarding where we are heading as a nation.
Firstly, on the economy. One of the primary objectives of the budget of 2022 was to bring about a consistent economic framework that allows large-scale to small-scale enterprises to structure long-term plans. Alongside this, the budget aims at bringing the deficit to 8.8% towards the end of 2022. A highlight of this effort was the one-time surcharge tax at a rate of 25%, charged from individuals or companies with a taxable income exceeding 2 billion rupees for the year of assessment from 2020 to 2021. This is intended to bring in 100 billion rupees to the government. In order to have a stronghold on the foreign reserve situation within the country, Sri Lanka has limited many imports, which includes vehicles. The halt in the importation of vehicles is to continue in 2022 as well. This has been coupled with the country reaching $3.1 billion in reserves towards the end of 2021. Sri Lanka will have to pay off $500 million in debt by January 2022 and another $1 billion by June. The finance minister, alongside the government, has demonstrated their capability to make these payments without defaulting on our debt obligations. Sri Lanka's export in 2021 for the rubber product sector alone has achieved $1 billion income, and Sri Lanka Export Development Board intends to increase it to $3 billion by 2025. For the period of January to November 2021, merchandise exports increased by 22.39% to $11,116 million compared to the corresponding period of 2020, following increased exports of almost all the major product sectors, which includes apparel and textiles, tea and rubber-based products. This is a strong position to hold as our country moves into 2022. As the new energy within the export sector seems to have taken effect. Sizable growth in export performance for specific countries has also been enhanced, with the United States seeing over double the exports witnessed last year during similar time periods. Two key areas that have seen massive transformative changes have been the fisheries and dairy industry. The fisheries sector exports have reached a historical high of over $287 million. The administration has also expressed a vision of making our country self-sufficient in milk. In assessing the pharmaceutical industry today, nearly 25% of all medicines in the state health sector are supplied locally, saving millions of dollars in foreign exchange. This has been enhanced by the investment zones created in Hambantota and the guaranteed buyback agreement implemented by the 2014 government of Sri Lanka. In lieu of these industrial developments, the measures taken by the central bank with a view to improve foreign exchange liquidity in the domestic market, such as introduction of incentive schemes for workers' remittances and the rules covering the repatriation and conversion of export proceeds, are also augmenting official reserves. In reference to the political situation, the opposition has been able to capitalize on certain disagreements within the government. However, given the economically turbulent time period we are currently within, it is a quite important feat to recognize the fact that the country is seeing a strong governing party with a powerful majority. This has been capitalized by the fact that after a long period of time, Sri Lanka has recognized a consistent foreign policy that is reflective of where the country aims to go towards in terms of its multilateral relationships. The Chinese foreign minister is expected to visit Sri Lanka on the 8th of January 2022. This will be symbolic of the priorities of the country as it moves towards an age of investments.
I personally think most certainly 2022 we might head to a food shortage. It's clear that the government doesn't have a path to drive this country in terms of economically, socially and politically. So the government has forgotten the fact that the country has fallen, and the government is trying to ignore the fact that we are in verge of bankruptcy. So what government should do, get together with all political parties, all opposition parties, and have them discuss with the government how to drive the country forward in 2022.
If you examine the situation in the country right now, and if you examine the situation over the past couple of months, perhaps past 18 months, I think we are in for a very difficult situation, extremely difficult situation in 2022.
As we all know that we are facing a shortage of foreign exchange, which is to be expected because our main foreign income is from tourism, which is, amounts to about 4.5 billion, and then about 6.6 billion on foreign employment, 1.2 by plantation and government industry and so on. So altogether, we have about, generally we envisage about 15 to 16 billion US dollars, which we feel not absolutely comfortable but manageable. Now, that has been lost, almost 80% of it in the last year and a half, or 2 years nearly. So, we are definitely struggling. Now, we are very optimistic and looking forward to work out effectively and efficiently to overcome this issue for 2020.
Sri Lanka has demonstrated immense prowess in the fight against COVID-19. This was enhanced by the current administration's commitment to vaccinate its entire population. Towards the end of 2021, Sri Lanka had given out the booster dose to close to 4 million people. Close to 65% of the population is fully vaccinated against COVID-19. It was this form of success that led to Sri Lanka leaving the country open for Christmas season as well. It is fair to assume that within the first few months of 2022, the country can reach a fully vaccinated status. This is further encouraged by the fact that 100% of the population above the age of 60 has been vaccinated against the coronavirus. The successful inoculation campaign provides a good protection against novel waves of the coronavirus.
We as a government and the health sector is making all necessary arrangements to meet any eventuality that is what down the pipeline. So that's where we stand at the moment. But we are very cautious, but we cautiously moving forward and knowing that there could be any kind of escalation of this pandemic.
We have now gone into the third vaccination also, and we will continue with the third vaccination. So the major issue we faced during the last 1.5 years, we have managed to resolve.
Divided opinions are present about how 2022 will manifest for the country. But if the people realize it's time to focus and build this nation to its true prowess, 2022 will be promising. Mahesh, I believe that message of hope is something that you'll want to focus on in today's program.
Yeah, exactly. Hope is something. I don't know whether you remember. One of the guests we had in the great Sri Lankan Reset series said, you know, hope is not exactly a solution. Hope
it's not a business plan.
Exactly. So for us as a nation, we got to start working and doing things. Danny Dutanavasam, thank you very much for that as well. That was Danny Dutanavasam with the real story there. Thank you very much. Let's take a short commercial break. On the other side, the Director General of the Government Information Department, Journalist Mohan Sanganayake, and economist Dr. Kenneth De Silva will join me to break down 2022. For all of us, this is Get Real. Back in a moment. If you're joining us right now, Happy New Year to you. Thank you very much for taking the time to check us out on this Get Real special presentation, analyzing Flash Forward 2022. In a new year right now, we are bringing in all the problems that we had in 2021 into 2022. So what we need to understand is exactly how will that impact this new year. Economically, politically, socially, even in the world, even here in Sri Lanka, we need to get an understanding exactly what kind of issues we need to keep an eye on and also focus on the opportunities we might have as a nation as we move on. So in order to do that, my guest tonight, I have the pleasure of being in the midst of the Director General of the Department of Government Information, Mr. Mohan Sambaranayake, and also Dr. Kenneth De Silva. He's a senior economist and the chairman of the Financial System Stability Consultative Committee of the Central Bank. We are expecting him in a moment, but
Mr. Samaranayake is here, veteran journalist whom you have seen for a very when I was small, I used to watch on Rupavahini the program which you have done about the world and all those things, very informative. It is indeed my honor to be having this discussion with you, sir. So let's talk about 2022. Before we get into the details, how do you see 2021, a pandemic year? We went through so much of hardship socially, politically. The government is facing a lot of problems right now. So what exactly do you think might happen in 2022?
Okay, before answering that question, please let me thank you, the Dharan team, for the invitation extended to me.
Yes.
Okay. And one more thing, I don't appear here in my capacity as the Director
Indeed.
General of Government Information, but as a journalist
Indeed.
Who has been keenly following both social, political, and economic developments, both locally and globally. Okay. My answer, very briefly, we have now, right now, we are in an extremely turbulent time. This is this turbulence has been there even before.
Yeah.
In the history of humanity, there were more turbulent times. For example, during the first 50 years, the 20th century, which was marked by two world global wars, during which millions and millions of people perished. In compared to that situation, we are in a better position.
Yeah.
Anyway, we are going through a highly turbulent times, which is marked by a global pandemic that emerged in December 2019 in the city of Wuhan in China. Still, it is not satisfactorily under control. There are mutations of the virus, and in one the developed countries, they are fast spreading, and there is an economic meltdown. According to the World Bank estimates, during the year 2020, the global economic growth was minus 4.5. And there is a contraction in all economic activities. This has resulted in not only in economic chaos, but also socially and politically. So if we take, for example, the situation in our country, everybody is agitated.
Yes.
Yeah. Everybody seems to be angry. Nobody seems to be happy. They are blaming the government. Things are going up, the prices of essential things are going up. There is a growing scarcity of goods and services. So it is not confined to Sri Lanka only. To my knowledge, even in a developed country like Canada, recently I saw news items to say that in 18 years, Canada's average price levels has gone up by 4.5%. It is also there, this situation can be seen in the United States, United Kingdom, and in certain so-called developing countries, it's extremely difficult situation. For example, Lebanon has been in darkness for months and months. So we are living in a highly turbulent, troublesome period. But at the same time, I believe this has provided a golden opportunity for us to think about the economic model that we have been that we have adopted both globally and locally. I may be deviating from the main topic, but let me give you an example. Now, for example, here now in our country, there is an acute shortage of depletion of foreign exchange reserves. Everybody knows that. It is alarming. There is no question. But what are the reasons behind this depletion of foreign exchange? How do you earn foreign exchange? You have to export goods and services. What we earn as foreign exchange, we spend on importations. If we can increase income from exports and control expenditure on imports, then that is the successful way of controlling this matter. In my view, after independence, Sri Lanka as a whole, that blame goes to all the governments that was in power after independence, has not evolved, developed a suitable economic model for the country, identifying our opportunities, strengths, weaknesses, level of development, people's aspirations. We have not. But this is my assessment. In early 60s, it must be, I am not a supporter or a member of any political party. This is my assessment. In early 60s, under Mrs. Sirimau Bandaranaike, there was an attempt to understand our potentials and to formulate a more or less suitable economic model for the country. The crux of the exercise was that there were considerable efforts to develop a national economy. That was disrupted when that government was ousted in 1965.
That government was ousted because people were not happy with that, because they were complaining, saying they don't have proper, anything to eat properly. There was no flourishing products to be sold. The economy was going through such a hard period of time. Even we had to ask China to come and help us. That was the time that Prime Minister Sirimau Bandaranaike actually had a very good rapport with China. I think that is one of the reasons China still respects us from that particular period onwards. You know, that happened. But right now, aren't we seeing the similarities of it? Right now, the president is saying, okay, let's stop the imports. We don't need to get everything imported. This country can generate it and increase the exports. Also, he wants to go in for a organic fertilizer driven agriculture. Lot of backlash for both. Same thing that happened for Prime Minister Sirimau Bandaranaike, which resulted in her being ousted from her from being in power. Do you think that is the similar situations in both these instances?
Okay, let me give you my explanation. The difficulties that you are talking about took place really not during the early period of 60s, but it was from the period from 1970 to 77. Okay, but during the period 1970 to 77, genuine effort was taken to build a strong national economic foundation. I believe without which no country can develop. For example, if you take the leading country in the world, the number one economy, that is the United States, how the United States has reached this level? During the 19th century, there was a widespread debate in the states what is the most suitable way for them to develop. During that discourse, I remember President Abraham Lincoln once said, I don't remember his exact words, but this is the meaning. He said, I don't know much about tariffs, but I know this much. If you buy things from abroad, we get the goods and money goes to the other foreign country. If you produce them locally here in our own country, we get both money and the goods. That is how United States developed. That was the model followed by the United Kingdom as well for about 200 years. During the period 1970 to 77, there was not exactly similar situation, but more closely, a trouble period, crisis-ridden period. It was during the early years of the 1970s, the first economic crisis of the capitalist world happened.
That's in the world?
Yes, in the globally. So after the end of the Second World War in 1945, capitalist economies continued to grow. Average 3% annually. At global level, 3% growth is a marvelous thing. Yeah. Right? Then in early 70s, it began to collapse. Really, what are the main indications of that crisis? Yes, there was economic meltdown, contraction during that period. United States abandoned the Bretton Woods Agreement, and there, during this period, took place the first oil shock. Before 1974, average price of a barrel of crude oil was about $170 something. By the beginning of the 74, it rose to $11 per barrel. So that was a crisis period that affected the efforts of the Mrs. Bandaranaike government. So I believe today also we are facing similar difficulties. My opinion is that if we were able to continue the policies initiated by the United Front government, I think we wouldn't have faced this kind of situation of this magnitude.
Mrs. Bandaranaike's approach for the economy, socially requesting people to think inwards, not outwards, and the very same thing President Abraham Lincoln told Americans is what Prime Minister Srimad Bandaranaike told this country. Now, that at that time you just said that the World War, the end of the World War, and the oil crisis is what that catapulted the difficult situation here in Sri Lanka in the 1970s. Now, global pandemic is occurring, and even though we have not yet seen the repercussions of it, because we are honestly saying that we are at an early stage of the pandemic. 2 years is not exactly something that you can analyze and say the repercussions of the pandemic might come to come and go. So that means we might look at the difficult period in the years ahead. So if that is what it is, what exactly do you think should occur? Because the thinking of Sri Lankans is so narrow-minded that they want everything to be like the way it was prior to the pandemic. People here do not understand the difficulties that people in countries like the United States, UK, they're going through. Our people get the food, they can go into the supermarkets, they can get the food, they can go into the polar, it's there. Prices are high, absolutely. That problem is there. But the supply has not eroded to the level it has eroded in the West or in certain parts of the East. So what do you think, if that same similar approach failed in the 70s, don't you think that is exactly what's going to happen right now? And in order to prevent that, what do you think we as Sri Lankans, not the government or anybody else, but as a nation, what do you think we need to think about?
Now, young gentlemen, I don't suggest that everything was rosy during that period. I don't say. There were many, many shortcomings and weaknesses, really. But still, that policy, I think, that is what matters in my view. Let me look at this example. Those days, we had textile factories in Tulhiriya, Pugada, Veyangoda, Minneriya. They were comparatively of fairly satisfactory quality. If they were there by now, what do you say? We may be on par with other countries, Bangladesh, even in China or other countries. We really the policy didn't fail in my view. It was defeated, it was cuttled and thwarted by an ideology which believed in liberalization. In my words, the so-called neoliberal economic model. That is what happened to us. The same thing happened to many other countries. As you correctly said, still average citizen doesn't understand this because they are struggling to make ends meet, so they don't understand. They have no time to understand, really. Yeah. The situation in this so-called middle, low-middle income country or the so-called developing country, the situation is very much better when compared to many countries of the world. Another example is this pandemic is now more or less controlled. No, we have to be at least for at the moment. True. There were predictions, doomsday predictions during the last several months. I can remember a person who appeared on television calling himself an international expert. He said by December there will be 1 million deaths. True. Now see, in the month of September, truly in, experts in the field of medical sciences, they even issued a statement. They said by December there will be 18,000 deaths, but it didn't happen.
Didn't happen.
And the, now the one of the reason for this success story is the vaccination drive.
Yes.
If you know the number of vaccines, vials that poor countries in the African country, African region received, we are far better than
the World Health Organization is issuing warning after warning, saying that we need to start vaccinating Africa.
Correct.
Because they are not getting the support that the rest of the world is getting, and hats off to the government for not sitting on it and waiting till everything goes down the drain in order to address it. Because as soon as the pandemic happened, everybody in the world said, you know, what is the solution? They said the solution is a vaccine. So the vaccine came very quickly to this country, and we didn't get some third grade or fourth grade vaccine. We got the best that is available in the world. Every single brand that is available in the world is available here in this country. And right now, I think we are vaccinating for the third dose. We have vaccinated for the third dose with Pfizer, which is considered to be the best vaccine that is out there. So yes, lot more to discuss with veteran journalist Mohan Samranaik. Before that, let's take a short commercial break. You're watching the New Year special of Get Real, Flash Forward 2022. What exactly to expect in this new year? Dr. Kenneth DeSilva will join us right after this short commercial break. You're watching Get Real. We'll be right back. Trail, the New Year special. If you're joining us, Happy New Year to you. Hoping to understand exactly what will 2022 bring us. 2021 was a difficult year, just like 2020. We rang in this decade with a pandemic, and here we are on the second year of it and trying to understand what will Sri Lanka will need to face in the year to come, economically, politically, socially. Where exactly will we be heading towards? Right now, I'm joined by veteran journalist Mohan Samranaik and also Dr. Kenneth DeSilva, senior economist and analyst of economic matters here in Sri Lanka and abroad. Let me start off with Dr. Happy New Year to you, Doctor, and welcome to the program. We all know end of 2021, there is a massive shortage of forex. That is not something that we can hide. Everybody is scared of you. Now the scaring part has already occurred. Now what is the plan? What do you think in 2022 will happen? The projections is as such, we will not have money to pay for fuel, we will not have for this and for that. So apparently doomsday scenario is being predicted by all kinds of people for 2022. What is your take?
Firstly, all the best for the new year and wish the station great success in the year ahead. Thank you, Mahesh, for the question. I think we saw 2021 being an extremely challenging year. By no stretch of the imagination, we as a country went in through a fairly dark patch in terms of our overall national cash flows. So this national cash flow stress was felt right across the country, and people itself had to kind of curtail some of their traditional consumption patterns. And that is a hard adjustment process for everyone. That was primarily because of the fact that our key variable, which is tourism, as in terms of the country's national balance sheet and cash flows, we lost out about $4 billion over the last 2 years, that is 2020 and 2021, which in terms, if you look at it, was about $8 billion on the national cash flow. On top of that, we had debt servicing also, and I think the same critics who are shouting now said the same thing in 2020 and 2021, that we will be unable to service our debt. We will go into this spiral of a crisis. We will default. And, you know, the whole lineup of negative thoughts were there. But somehow we have managed through that. And that pain process has now kind of eased off. Why I say eased off is if you look at the numbers in tourism, which was about 680 million in 2020, 2021, it reached about, I think, $250 million, which is a slight turn up. And 2022, we feel that with the opening of borders, mobility of people across the world, governments themselves want people to move, and you know, that global mobility coming back into focus, Sri Lanka will be a beneficiary of that. And with that footfall, I think tourism will increase. And those numbers from our national cash flows, we are looking at about $1 billion to be a safe side. Generally, tourism has been about 3.5 to 4 billion, but on a conservative estimate, we are looking at $1.5 to $1 billion on a national cash flow, which means we are better off than what we were in 2021. So to answer your question, I think, yes, the doomsday sayers would be still out there trumpeting this particular slogan. It's part and parcel of their agenda. I mean, we quite understand that. And we also welcome that because it gives us determination and challenge to prove them wrong, and we have proved them wrong. And the same people who continue to listen to these doomsday sayers should now realize that the so-called event of default has not come, and it will not come in 2022 as well.
In mid-December 2021, Fitch Ratings downgraded us, said, you know, apparently we will be looking towards defaulting, and the country is, again, the same doomsday you said, if by any chance, if I say it, would be Fitch Ratings, and all these kinds of people. Now, 2022, we are hoping to attract more investors here because we have a huge project, some bunch of sand next to the Colombo city, hoping to get that filled with businesses to come in and start investing. What do you think overall for the investors per se in that particular outlook? Because nobody wants to go and invest in a country that is unstable economically or politically. Nobody wants to put their hand into that. So what do you think, if by any chance these international organizations are not exactly helping us in order to get away from this, because they're treating us as if we are the only country who has faced this global pandemic, and we don't see Fitch Ratings saying United States downgraded or China downgraded. It's countries like ours. So in a case like that, what do you think for what would be the message that you would want the investors to think rather than just reading out those notes coming out from these agencies?
Yeah. I mean, frontier markets have always been a primary focus for any long-term investor, and particularly in the context of Asia being the next 50 years of growth in the overall business cycle, investors are looking for discounted assets. And within that framework, I think Sri Lanka sits fairly well with a fairly undervalued asset portfolio. And these asset portfolios are relatively attractive for investors looking for long-term gains. And therefore, Sri Lanka still stands to benefit from that.
Now, the environment that you need to create is one that is of stability and consistency in policy, I think, which is what the budget 2022 has done. There was no tinkering around the overall fiscal policy, even though people are pushing taxes to be revised and various other revenue measures to be brought in. I think it was a sensible decision to keep that untouched, because I think this particular government, when it came into its tenure, made a pledge to this country and said that we are going to have a fixed fiscal policy for the 5 years. And within that fiscal framework and the macro framework, the government still is well within that. When I say the macro framework, you're looking at a real sector GDP, a real GDP of about 6.5% growth. We are looking at keeping inflation moderate. Global inflation is also moderating. So with inflation moderating, I think you will find the stability coming in the monetary policy side, which is the interest rate structure. Interest rate structure, as you know, was a double-digit interest rate structure, which made capital formation extremely costly. So all in all, I think the benefits of that sound macroeconomic policy still stands firm. There have been challenges in 2021. There will be in 2022. Definitely. But I think we have to stick with that framework. If we stick within that framework, I'm very confident that the investors will see that through. And in their pricing, that makes a difference. I'll give you one example in the overall infrastructure financing model. Now, we relied heavily on external funding for our infrastructure projects, particularly the highways, waterways, all these must-have infrastructure for any investor to come in, because connectivity and the networking in Sri Lanka needs to be there, that whole passage of infrastructure needs to be built. Now, as I said, traditionally we went and got foreign currency funding. That was a costly exercise because there is a premium on top of that, there is credit insurance on top of that, and then also the rupee depreciation adds to our national cash flows, and it's unmanageable. Now, the shift is this. Now, because with interest rate structure being flat and manageable, domestic banks have stepped in to fund construction and the consortiums. So up to about 80 billion, 90 billion rupees of funding is now being pushed by the consortium of banks and a consortium of
private sector
construction companies have got together and formed that. So now we have a much more manageable cash flow, much more predictable cash flow, non-dependent on foreign exchange and foreign debt. So that shift is good. Now, for that particular model to work, you need stability
exactly.
in interest rates and exchange rates. Only then can this long-term annuity type of model come into play. And I think that's a big plus for Sri Lanka. We are looking at our debt mix, shifting it from where it is, from a foreign currency dependent balance sheet debt to a domestic dependent. And that ratio is now fast improving, where we are concentrating about 60% domestic debt, 40% foreign debt, which becomes manageable. Gradually, we want to bring it down and we want to reduce our external debt. That is the idea. And with that, I think you get enough of fiscal space. So to answer your question, I think the macro framework is something that is important. The fiscal policy is important. And within the global framework, if you look at Asia, Sri Lanka sits fairly well within that environment. And the discounted asset type of attraction will make foreign investors come into Sri Lanka.
Mrs. Amaranagana, in order to make these kinds of things work, there should be political stability in this country, in any other country for that matter. We can't have volatility in politics where we do not know whether this government will come in or go, what will happen in the parliament. We have no idea. Now, if we talk about politics in Sri Lanka, now that is a very sour topic. Because people are not attracted to it at all. Every single problem in this country, people have managed to say it's because of the politicians. And right now, what we see is for every single step that is being taken, despite the fact that we are going through a global pandemic, a national crisis whatsoever, we do not see political parties coming together. And we see more division among them, rather than even within the government, we see certain factions forming and all those kinds of things. Now, political stability, what do you forecast for 2022 for this country? What do you think? Will we have elections after election? Because there is an election that is supposed to come in this year. But what exactly would that be? Would there be a power shift? And how would that impact the overall growth of this country?
Okay. My assessment is that we do have political stability in the country since the defeat of LTTE terrorism in 2009. True, there are demonstrations here and there, but overall political stability is there. Number two, all majority of indications are that the situation will ease. Now pandemic is more or less controlled. It has reached a manageable level. Now the daily infections are around 450, like that. So under these circumstances, in the current year, the situation will be better, much better than the two previous years. So like in the current situation, investors will come, tourists will arrive, it will be on the rise, and the income and foreign exchange earning as well. So in the meantime, government can implement its manifesto that was placed before the people during the election. The first thing is the most important aspect of that manifesto is to build a production economy based on nationally available resources while utilizing internationally accepted technologies and standards. And when it comes to the political divisions within the government, that's a problem that has to be sorted out. This is a coalition government. So in a coalition, all parties must understand their role. If not, it will lead to a collapse. That happened at the end of 1977. There was the United Front government failed because of these deep-rooted divisions within the coalition. And really before the 77 election, two parties left the coalition. And the same thing happened again in 2015. In 2015, the presidential candidate came from the very ruling party at that time. So this need to be understood by all members of the present political alliance. Otherwise, it will end in disaster for both for them and as well as the people of the country. My assessment is that in 1977, people made a wrong decision. Still, we have not been able to overcome some of these, the consequences. So in 2015 also similar thing happened, that all parties, members of the current coalition, present coalition must understand this bitter reality.
Not only in 77 people did the mistake, I think in 2015 also they did that, because that translated economically. Let's take the port city by 2015, the port city, I mean if the projections or if the timeline was adhered to, by 2017 we would have had the port city up and running. 2018, 2019 we would have had investors here, and because of that stupid action that was taken in 2015 is the reason that we are here talking about it. We have a bunch of sand, you know, a pile of sand right there next to Goldface. So don't you think how did that in your opinion, Dr. Kenneth, did that really actually impacted our economy, because we stopped and we gave the world saying, you know, it doesn't matter, just because we sign a contract does not mean we are abiding kind of a nation. If by any chance if we don't like it, we will ask. So that kind of created such a bad taste in the investor forum globally. What do you think? Do you think we would have been in a better position in case with the port city would have been up and running and we've been functioning?
Yeah, Mahesh, I'll just pick up from what Mohan just mentioned about a production economy. I think that's a vital cog in this whole journey of looking at an alternate economic policy. People have been criticizing this alternate economic policy. The alternative economic policy is nothing but looking at global market share. How do we look at economies of market share? right? No one teaches this in school, right? So when you go to look at exporters, if you look at our trade balance, from our trade balance, we had a negative trade balance right along. That has filtered in through our to our current account. And we have been talking about this twin deficit from, I think, Mohan, probably from the 1970s, we have been talking about this twin deficits.
Correct.
And it was a good tea discussion and a cocktail discussion for many people. Now we have to translate that and we have to take actions to correct that mistake. Otherwise, there is no point looking at an alternative which is based on production, right? So the alternative looks at production from a going global point of view. How do we take our exporters global? How do we capture global market share? For all those action points, you need to have sound policy. You need to have sound monetary policy. You need to have sound fiscal policy. You need to have sound industrial policy. You need to have a sound investment policy. And that comes to your question about looking at port city. Now, port city is a gateway. Is a gateway connecting the east and west, right? We sit in the middle. And that gateway will produce an economy of about $100 billion turnover when it's finally completed, right? Now, Sri Lanka has to be ready to capture that global market share. If we don't, we will get back to what we were doing, which is importing and supplying the consumers that patronize this global village. Now, are we looking at that type of model, or do we say no, let's line up all our producers, let's get them to global standards, let's invest in them, let's give them the technology and the know-how to become global, and let's push them. It's like this big push, right? Korea did it,
yes.
China did it, Germany did it, Malaysia did it. Why not Sri Lanka?
Exactly.
Why not Sri Lanka? So that global push needs to be coming from multifaceted type of approaches, where we have the government pushing from one side, private sector working hand in hand, and also the technocrats falling in line with this and making this journey and converting it into an enabling environment, because the private sector has to run with this. Government can't get into production. They can do in some areas, but more or less it is the private sector, and that's why we want private sector people of manufacturing furniture, electronics, food products, beverages, poultry, the proteins, the vegetables. All this has to be provided for this gateway. Otherwise, we will get into a serious balance of payments crisis. Therefore, lining up the entrepreneurs, the manufacturers to this journey is paramount. And that's why I think that, as you said, that investment environment needs to be a conducive one, and it has to be an environment where we partner the countries. We can't do this in isolation.
Yeah, yeah.
And China is a key part of this. I mean, whether you like it or not, they are the global superpower. And that has been already
economic
established.
Superpower.
Global and economic superpower. So we by trying to antagonize them, is not going to serve us in any shape or form, irrespective of which political party.
All right, let's take a short commercial break. You're watching the special on Get Real with regard to what exactly 2022 will bring for us, and for us to understand what would this year be, and more importantly, not that, how should we as Sri Lankans help this drive rather than sitting at home complaining, because then we're really good at doing that. I think we did it for since independence, so why not make a change? Let's take a short commercial break. You're watching Get Real. We'll be right back. Special Flash Forward 2022. I'm here with veteran journalist Mohan Samaranaike and also senior economist Dr. Kenneth De Silva. We've been talking about the economic policies and the economic situation that we might face in 2022, and also political stability that needs to be brought in by the people, not by anyone else. America is not going to bring us political stability, so we have to do that. Try to understand. Mr. Samaranaik, in this final segment, let me ask from you. When we try to do something new in this country, what we've seen is such a negative outlook from the get-go. Let's take the carbonic fertilizer, which, I mean, like, if you take the gist of it, what the president is telling the people is, don't eat poison. This is all what he's saying. Let's make our food in such a manner we do not eat poison, because by consuming that, we are getting so much of other diseases and sicknesses and all those things. Maintaining that is a higher price. So why not avoid it? Prevention is better than cure. So this is what he's saying. So, but from the get-go, everybody was saying no, 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 no. And some were coming up with, there are a lot of agendas running in this country. And in the midst of it, it's the people who gets caught in all this nonsense. Political parties are pulling it towards the way that they want. If you take a look at the opposition is you say if the government says one thing, they will always say something against it. That's it. And whereas it should be, you know, okay, let's say something to better it. That should have been the approach of the opposition. To say, no, we have a better understanding of doing this in a better manner. But that is not what we see. Mentality, approach, all this is in negative territories. What do you think? 2022, do you think is a golden opportunity for the people of this country to think differently? Because if we don't think differently, I don't think we can come out of this mess.
My answer is yes. Towards the end of the Second World War, there was a similar situation globally. It comes to my mind in 1944, the Austrian economist, wrote a book called The Great Transformation, in which he advised the humanity, the global community, not to totally believe in the directorship of the market. Then what went wrong with us, in my belief, is that we accepted, we believe in an economic model which is beneficial ultimately to the powerful and rich countries of the world. In 2002, a Cambridge University economist like Dr. Kenneth, his name is Ha Joong Chang, okay. He wrote a book called Kicking Away the Ladder, Development Strategy in Historical Perspective. There he argues, he was not a communist, not a socialist. Yeah. I'm also not talking about socialism, I'm talking about national capitalism. Mm. There in that book, Ha Joong Chang argues, the currently developed countries have reached that status by adopting a production economic model.
Yeah.
So that is what went wrong. We need to rectify this situation.
Yeah. Just to add to that, South Korea also did the same thing that we are doing right now.
Exactly, exactly. Take India or China for that matter. They have laid their strong economic foundation based on which they opened their economies and became rich. Able to attract huge amounts of foreign investments. That is how now China is the country with the largest volume of surplus capital. So as Dr. Kenneth said, we cannot antagonize China in this situation.
Sure. And in terms of people, what do you think their approach should be? What should they be thinking 2022? Because if you put on the television, or if you read a newspaper, go on social media, such a negative. I mean, I don't understand why people keep entertaining this and why people are not fed up of this negativity on a daily basis, because you can't take such negativity on a daily basis on this country, not have a nationalistic value, be proud about being Sri Lankan. And that is not being injected into our system these days. If you look at the politicians, they are divided. If you look at the society, they're divided. If you look at even our own home, they are divided. So what do you think, what is your advice to the people? You know, we got to start new, we have to start somewhere, we got to start somehow. In order to go to like countries like South Korea, they pretty much stopped the importation of vehicles, and then they started doing their own domestic production, which actually become a brand. I think Hyundai is the brand that started at that particular moment, because that was a homemade innovation, which is now global. Like that, thinking has to be one. What is your advice, 2022? What should people of this country be thinking about and directing their life towards?
People should be made aware of the real situation, both globally and locally. I think blame goes to the government in power. They do not educate people. They don't go before the people to tell them what is really happening in other countries and in our own country as well. I think the ruling parties have failed to convince people. The situation regarding the pandemic, Sri Lanka has done very well when compared to many countries of the world. I remember in September there was an article in the magazine Economist. It says of the total number of vaccinations doses produced globally, only 4.1% have gone to the African and other poorest countries of the world, whereas we have done much better. So I think government must initiate an ideological offensive.
Very true. Let me come to Dr. Kenneth Disilva. I'll give you the last word, Doctor.
Yes.
Economically, right now, it is going to be hard. That is not something that I don't think the finance minister, the government should be telling, you know, painting a rosy picture for the people and telling everything is going to be okay in 2022. There could be certain changes we may have to do as a nation, not just individually, but we are doing this for this entire country, because in the future, if you're talking about the future generations and all, they are the ones who we are working for. And one of the things that people don't understand right now is we are in a pandemic. In Sri Lanka, we have everything. Like what Mr. Samaranayake said, vaccinations, right there. We are now finished, I think, almost the third dose. Mm. If by any chance there's
we didn't lose our salary, even
exactly.
Part of it.
Yeah. Government sector was paid, protests occurred. Yeah. Continuously, and the best thing is what people don't realize is they think the indication of, you know, a higher number of protests means that there's failure. No, that is a part of democracy, and that particular right is being exercised by anybody. So that kind of things is happening. Economically, what do you think? What is your projection for 2022, and where should this economy should be driven towards to?
Yeah, so I'm going to pick up from what Mohan said, which is spot on in terms of looking at what Ha Jun Chang has written in his book, Kicking Away the Ladder. I mean, I was a keen and an avid reader of Ha Jun Chang's many papers. In fact, we got
There's
him down.
There's another avid reader in our production.
We got him down for the central bank, and I think we will get him down this year as well to give a few more lectures, which is a must for Sri Lanka, because Sri Lanka has been taught only liberal economics.
Yeah.
No one has looked at economic history and understood how these countries developed, what are the policy measures they initiated, what are the tariff structures they initiated, right? By that only these countries developed. I mean, all the global superpowers have done the same thing. I mean, when Sri Lanka does it, it's a huge, hue and cry or nothing. But this is the reality. So we have to get back to what we are trying to do in terms of getting the production economy on track. That doesn't happen in 2 years or three years. And for that, I think political consistency is a must. We have made those mistakes repeatedly. And as a result, we have gone on the begging bowl to the IMF from 1965.
Just a comment on the fact, everybody is saying, go to the IMF, because they are the savior. Lord and savior is the IMF. What do you think?
I am not a keen advocate of IMF or any kind of external entity coming into Sri Lanka and trying to look at managing Sri Lanka's national balance sheet, because it's unique to Sri Lanka. There is no cut and paste model, which IMF generally does. mean, I have gone through many of their papers, and you find it's identical. From 1965, if you look at the structure adjustment process and the various other documents they have come up with, it's the same, identical. So if you have gone 16 times, you have failed and not got the results, well, why should you go again? I mean, unless someone is absolutely brain dead to do this, then you would go again. I mean, there is no need, because we have done most of the changes in the last 2 years, and we are coming out of it. We have serviced our debt, we have turned the economy, we have put production on track, production is coming through. I mean, we are seeing great numbers on the fisheries sector. For the first time in 2021, fisheries sector had a trade surplus. After 2014, which was $122 million, 2021, it is about $200 million. So it is significant, and there is a huge turnaround, because we were continuously importing fish, and we had a trade deficit. So that is one sector. Like that, there are multiple sectors. You look at the furniture manufacturing sector, those order books are full. You're talking about South Korea. South Korea, when they started their steel drive and heavy chemical and industrialization drive, they didn't have steel. They didn't have the technology. They didn't have the finances. They didn't have the raw materials. But they went ahead. They took a loan from, I think, Russia and Japan, because the World Bank and IMF didn't give them. And they took $300 million and started steel. Today, Hyundai Corporation and Kia and other car manufacturers and electronic manufacturers are a product of that particular policy decision, which lasted 20, 30 years. All these countries have consistent policies for 30 years, including Singapore, which is a single government, democracy, right? Which has a policy for 50 years. No one talks about those.
Exactly.
So that is the story. So for 2022, I think the political economy is going to be volatile. There's going to be more external pressure, because as we put ourselves on track with this production economy, you are going to get more brickbats than bouquets. And you have to expect that, because it's going to be painful again, because it's import replacement. Import replacement industries have to be given priority, and that we are seeing happening with pharmaceuticals, with fertilizer, with milk, with fisheries, and multiple other sectors, which is a good development for Sri Lanka. And I think 2022, we will reach some of the key milestones, and I think the economy, in terms of its overall GDP growth, will get to about 6.5 in 2022.
Positive outlooks from both individuals, veteran journalist Mohan Samaranaik, and also senior economist Dr. Kenneth De Silva. My sincere appreciation. When you were talking about why people are not looking at America's, you know, how they started the South Korea, how they started, mainly it attributes to the fact that our people do not know about it, because they didn't have social media at that time. So if by any chance they had it, they would have known about, our people would have known about it. But then again, when you were also talking about people asking, you know, brain dead people asking to go to the IMF, we know who those brain dead people are, the ones who are screaming about going to the IMF. Gentlemen, thank you very much. I really appreciate you spending your New Year evenings with me and trying to tell our people, you know, everything is not doom and gloom. And that is something that I've been trying to push through this program right throughout the Sri Lankan. As Sri Lankans, we have to be proud about our country, and we have to work for this country. America is not going to come and help us to grow or anything.
Neither China.
Exactly. We have to do it by ourselves. Speaking is good, understanding is good, but then we have to get to work. And I hope that everyone at home would determine in 2022 that we will all get to work towards the betterment of this country. Once again, thank you very much to Dr. Kenneth, Mr. Samaranaik, for being here. And also, I thank you for watching. In case you missed this program, you can rewatch it on youtube.com/otherbetterenglish. And also, have a conversation with us on Facebook. facebook.com/getrealderna. Thank you very much for watching. That's all the time we have for you. Make sure, at least in 2022, continue to stay positive and also test negative. I'll see you next time.
Yeah. I want that red velvet. I want that sugar sweet. Don't let nobody touch it unless that somebody's me. I gotta be a man. There ain't no other way. Cause girl, you're hotter than a Southern California day. I don't want no makeup.